Hey, Bongekile here, bringing you the latest updates. Please don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification button so that you do not miss anything I upload.
Today, ngizobe nginifundela amathizazi embewu for u-Agasti. Kuthiwa Ngcolosi can't believe his eyes in mid-June. His dream were crushed when his mistress Zandile miscarried, and in mid-July he lost the son he'd raised Zithulele to his real biological father Ngcolosi's brother Phakade. But in the final week of August, what was lost will come back, and once Ngcolosi is sure, there's nothing he wouldn't do for Terry's boy Nkululeko. At first, it's a lot to take in for. Okay, it's a lot to take in for Ngcolosi when he found out through devious means that his new head of security, Nkululeko, the man who literally came out of the darkness to save his life in mid-April, has run a DNA test. He first think that he was set up. The way he met and trusted Nkululeko blindly, he thinks that the DNA test is forged and is to ridiculate him, admits Tony. He doesn't trust anyone, especially after finding out that the kids he raised as his own were his brothers. Okay, he's skeptical that Nkululeko is even his son. But Ngcolosi can't stop from hoping, and that makes things worse, because with that hope comes the fear that he will somehow lose his son too. Ngcolosi quietly conducts his DNA test, and he's floored. He feels grace that he has his own son. He felt Zithulele betrayed him by accepting Phakade as his dad, but he thanks the ancestors for bringing Nkululeko back into his life, says Tony. But even though he is uncomfortable knowing that Zithulele is not biologically his son, this doesn't change Ngcolosi's feeling. In African tradition, brothers share sons. Now that he knows the truth, Ngcolosi flings open his heart. He knows that he's missed on a lot of years. Ngcolosi loves going all out for his children, and Nkululeko is no different. He wants to introduce him with a bang to a family and show off, reveals Tony. Nkululeko was first a trusted employee and now even closer his son. But Ngcolosi is no fool. He knows that at least one of his kids will see him giving Nkululeko is taking from her. There will be a competition from Zakithi as his son. Okay, there will be competition from Zakithi as his son can claim the empire for himself, warns Tony. So previously on Imbewu, Kamadonsela feared that she was being called to become a sangoma. Phakade was awarded 25% of Maluju shares, and Naveen tried to attack Mira at work after she dimed him. Then on the 14th to the 16th of August, Phakade attends his first Maluju board meeting, but Mandlovu argues him to mind his own business, and Ngcolosi asks Nkululeko to act as his witness when he changes his will. Zakithi tells Nkululeko that they are related. Khanyo calls a prayer meeting, and Naveen is arrested after he attacks Buhle. From 19 to 23 August, Nkululeko takes a DNA test, but Phunyuka slips Ngcolosi the results, which leads to Ngcolosi rejecting Nkululeko despite knowing that he is the biological son. Phakade arrives to find his wife Kamadonsela in a sangoma shawl. Naveen secretly gets out of jail, and Mira goes public to expose her abusive relationship. Pranav and Nairupa's marriage, meanwhile, is back in business after they join forces to help Mira. On 26 to 27 August, Ngcolosi embraces Nkululeko as his son and gives him a promotion. And Matsingwane tells Gamadonsela that she needs cleansing. Mira, meanwhile, smashes Navini's shrine to her after he steals her underwear from her home. Then the rampa side must think that Mira. That's Mira's nightmare relationship with her abusive, obsessive lover Navin is over after Navin is arrested for attacking Mira's friend Buhle in mid-August. But when the legal system fails Mira yet again and Navin is released from jail days later, there is worse to come. Mira has two routes to managing her trauma. The first, undergoing therapy. The second, facing Navin head on. Over the coming fortnight, she will try both. Before Navin's arrest, Mira's sense of helplessness is overwhelming. A huge contributing factor to this feeling is that throughout the ordeal, the legal system favors Navini's rights over her. He does anything he can to humiliate and torture her. Ads in the media that paints her out to be a woman of loose character. He sends weird and disgusting parcels to her house. He constantly threatens her. He reminds Mira that he still has his eyes on her, and if she won't be with him, he will simply destroy her, reveals Mishka. And despite his continuous harassment, Mira is told that nothing can be done. This is a nightmare that never ends. At this point, she is ready to accept death because she doesn't have hope anymore, explains Mishka. Many times, legal and justice system lets down women in abusive relationship, either due to lack of evidence, corruption, or plain laziness. The investigating officer do Mira one favor though. When they suggest she seek professional help, she agrees only to make everyone happy, admits Mishka. Through her therapy sessions, viewers will see Mira and not okay. Will okay. Throughout the therapy sessions, viewers will see Mira and not wanting to give herself to healing process as she can no longer trust anybody. Her soul is completely shattered, but as her therapist, Elaine, starts to describe the type of person Navini really is, the unhealthy relationship they shared, and what could have been their future, Mira experiences a revelation. It is one thing listening to outside views regarding situation, but when the process of self realization takes place, that is when she truly makes a huge breakthrough. But while Mira's healing has begun, Navin has been left to run wild around town. And the violation that Mira feels when she discovered that he has stolen personal intimate items from her bedroom to build a shrine to her It led to a shocking confrontation in the last week of August. At this point of the story, Mira is even considering. Mira is even considering murdering Naveen because she feels that maybe the only way she can truly be safe from him. When she goes to confront him with a knife in her hand, she is already in a frenzy, and when she sees the shrine, it is as if the little bits of hope she had in her heart disappears. All this emotion pushes her to completely lose control, reveals the actress. Naveen's shrine doesn't just violate Mira's privacy, it hints to his potentially deadly intentions. The shrine is built in a strange manner. In Hinduism, when a person passes on, a photograph of the deceased will be printed and framed and adorned with a garland of flowers and placed at a prayer area or by the lamp. This is exactly what Naveen does with the shrine to her, says Mishka. No wonder Mira goes ballistic, but once she destroys Naveen's dream, what will the violent abuser do to him? Behind the scenes, Mishka had one chance to get his right physically. It was challenging. I had only one shot at destroying the shrine, and there was a lot of pressure to do it right. It was exhausting. There was glasses smashed against walls. Things were torn and objects were flung around the room. I had to enter a moment of complete loss and control and lose myself completely in order to bring the scene to life and experience the true emotion and what my character is going through, despite the safety hazards, she reveals. So thank you so much for watching. I hope you didn't forget to subscribe. Thank you so much. Bye. Essa é a